Anyway, let's talk this morning. I mentioned maybe about a month ago, I did a presentation in ladies' Bible class about dispensational premillennialism, and that's a lot of words, there's a lot of syllables there. You may not be familiar with either of these terms, and that's okay. You don't have to know what Zionism is. You don't have to know what dispensational premillennialism is to be saved. But by virtue of what's going on in our world, I wanted to begin this year talking about, I know next year, tomorrow's the new year, but I want to begin by sharing some thoughts about Israel, because it's in our news, right?
Yeah.
A lot of religious broadcasting is focused in on, you know, about the land of Israel, and does modern Israel have a right to those things? We're going to talk about that from the Bible perspective, but you can't do that without understanding some things about some philosophies in our world. These two concepts that you see on your screen are related, although they're not identical in one sense of the term. Zionism is a Jewish nationalistic movement that began in the late 19th century. Most attribute a man by the name of Theodor Herzl with kind of the beginning of that, but it's a Jewish nationalistic effort to reclaim what it believes is its homeland. And a lot of that, you can be a Zionist without claiming to believe the Bible, at least from a Christian perspective. So that's why I've separated the two. Dispensational premillennialism, though, is a distinctly evangelical construct that is closely linked to Zionism. And that's why you kind of get a melding of the two in what's referred to today as Christian Zionism. Because there's a big push in some circles to promote the idea that modern-day Israel has a God-given right to the land, the Holy Land, as it's referred to in many circles. So we're just setting the stage today. I'm going to be talking about a lot of things that kind of from a historical perspective, just setting the stage for some questions we're going to deal with, Lord willing, in the next few weeks. So again, that's probably all you need to know about that part of it. Brother Jim sent me a good article about Christian Zionism. Several pages, and if you'd like a copy of that, I can email that to you or give you a print copy. Let me know later, and I can share that with you. Appreciate that. I did some study on this, though, and there's some problems with dispensational premillennialism that, and I'm going to quit saying that because I start to mess that up after a while. Pre-mill, maybe we'll just talk about that. What's this idea about millennialism anyway? You hear it in some circles and you would say, well, the Bible must be full of talk about a millennium or a thousand-year reign. Well, oddly enough, there's only about seven or eight verses that talk about it. And it's also included in a very highly symbolic book, the book of Revelation. Let me just read you what the Bible has to say directly about the millennium. Whether you're premillennial or postmillennial or amillennial, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. Revelation chapter 20, in verses 1 through 7, you can follow along in your Bibles or just listen, but this is basically what the Bible says about the millennium. John in Revelation says, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding the key of the abyss and a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of the dragon, the serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for a thousand years." There you have it. What's translated there is the idea of the millennium. That means a thousand years. "And he threw him into the abyss and shut it and sealed it over him so that he would not deceive the nations any longer until the thousand years were completed. After these things, he must be released for a short time. Then I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was given to them, and I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony of Jesus and because of the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received the mark on their forehead and on their hand, and they came to life and reigned with Christ for a thousand years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the thousand years were completed. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these the second death has no power. They will be priests of God and of Christ, and reign with him for 1,000 years. So there you have, in those 7-8 verses, it mentions the millennium several times. But this is the only place in the Bible that talks about it. But as is the case in a lot of other things, Revelation, due to the fact that it's a very highly symbolic book, is a breeding ground for a lot of philosophies, and some of them I don't think have a lot of biblical basis. But there are basically three millennial views. They'll take this section and form a doctrine. And you've got, first of all, premillennialism, or premillennial. See, it's starting to happen. Premillennial. And I'll just give you a brief outline of this philosophy. Premillennialism. Premill.
Amen.
That's right. Premill is the belief that the kingdom of God involves a literal millennial 1,000-year reign of Christ on earth, then follows the final judgment. And you've got classical or historical premillennialism, and then you've got dispensational premill. There's a bit of a difference. But they say, well, this 1,000-year reign of Christ will be literal, and it'll precede the judgment. Then you've got postmillennial. Postmill is the belief that the church is destined to conquer the world and usher in the golden age of the millennium. This was, ironically, the majority view of restoration preachers in the early years of the Churches of Christ in America. It has now largely fallen out of favor. And then finally, you've got amillennial. This is the view that the kingdom of God is in existence now and is realized in the church and in the salvation, with no literal earthly millennium in store for the future. In amill, the 1,000-year reign is considered a metaphor and a spiritual symbol. And this is perhaps, amill is the predominant view in most Churches of Christ now. These three cover most of the religious landscape as far as the millennium. Now, you may say, oh, I've never heard of any of this. Well, that's fine. We're focusing primarily, though, on premillennialism, dispensational premillennialism. Now, you may not have heard of the doctrine, but you've probably heard of some of the people who promote it, one way or the other. Let me give you a little historical background of premill. Even though some individuals held various aspects of it earlier, the modern version, and again, some will claim, oh, this doctrine comes from the Bible, and they'll go back and find threads that they say, well, here you can see it, but premill basically had its beginning with a man named John Nelson Darby, or J.N. Darby. He lived from 1800 to 1882. Early 19th century. He was a preacher among the Plymouth Brethren in England in the early 1800s, but he's usually credited as the guy who kind of got the ball rolling for all of this premill teaching. Then you've got a man named W.E. Blackstone, 1841 to 1935. He gave added influence to the idea. He was an ardent promoter of it. He was a Methodist preacher. His book entitled Jesus is Coming, copyrighted in 1898, has now been printed in 40 languages. You may have heard of Darby, probably haven't heard of Blackstone, but you probably have heard of C.I. Schofield. Even if you didn't know the man, you may have heard of the Schofield Reference Bible. You may have even owned one in the past. Cyrus Ingerson Schofield lived from 1843 to 1921. He was the background for this Schofield Reference Bible. He was a Congregationalist minister, a lawyer, and a former U.S. attorney for Kansas who developed this Bible. The Schofield Bible wasn't a new translation. It used the King James as its basis, but it was a special edition, if you will, of the King James, full of C.I. Schofield's Bible study notes, one of the first maybe study Bibles. And I've got nothing against study Bibles. I own several. You probably have one. And a study Bible can be a help. It usually has the Bible up here, maybe in a column, and then down below it has a particular scholar's take on that, or maybe a group of scholars. And, And they're a good tool if you're careful. But the problem comes, and it came with the Scofield Reference Bible, because some people couldn't see the difference between what the Bible said and what Scofield said. Because they get a Bible argument somewhere. It says, well, my Bible says this is pre-mill. Well, the Bible doesn't use that word. Anyway, in it, Scofield never argued, explained, or apologized, or assigned any reasons for asserting what he wrote was true. It does continue to be very popular. When it was introduced, hundreds of thousands of dollars were spent to promote it and advertise it. So this became a springboard for, again, the dispensational pre-mill idea. It promoted that in its study notes. There's some more modern promoters of this. William Miller, you may have heard of him. He lived in the 1800s. He was the guy who predicted the second coming of Jesus in 1843, and it didn't happen. Then he predicted, well, it'll be next year, 1844, and it didn't happen. He predicted it in 1845, and guess what? After three tries, people finally gave up on William Miller, and he went into obscurity. I mean, people basically sold all their possessions because they believed that Christ was coming back when Miller said he was a believer in pre-mill. Ellen White, one of the founders of Seventh-day Adventists, was pre-mill. Charles Taze Russell, founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses, was staunchly pre-mill. Joseph Smith, you've heard of him. He was the founder and Latter-day Prophet of the Mormon Church. He was strongly influenced by the leaders of premillennial teaching. Those of you who grew up or maybe were teenagers or young people in the 70s, maybe heard of Hal Lindsey. Book, The Late Great Planet Earth, very popular in the 70s. He was a springboard he was pre-mill, and his book promoted that idea. Other prominent proponents of premillennial teaching were Charles Ryrie, John Walburn, Martin DeHaan, Garner Ted Armstrong, Edgar Wisenot, and Billy Graham. So some well-known religious folks. So there's a large camp of people that believe this. But guess what? Truth isn't decided by how many are on the side of it, right? Just because you got a large group of people that believe something doesn't make it necessarily right. And I think that's part of the problem here. It has to be recognized that there's a lot of different strains of this, and you know, you might say, well, I believe this, but I don't believe all of what you're saying. There are as many strains of premillennialism as there are religious denominations, but there are four primary teachings that are most recognizable from this doctrine. I'm going to list them for you in a moment, and these will be a springboard for the following lessons that, Lord willing, will be coming up. These four teachings are the most readily recognized points, with some minor variations, of the doctrines of dispensational pre-mill, which concern Christ and his kingdom. I want you to listen carefully as I list these, and you just start thinking about the implications of some of these teachings. Again, we'll get into it a little more in the coming weeks. First of all, pre-mill teachers believe that Israel, the literal physical descendants of Abraham through Jacob, will be nationally converted and restored en masse to the land of Palestine, or the Holy Land, whatever word you like to use for that part of the world. And again, this is the part of the doctrine that is as current as today's newspaper. Because you have pre-mill teachers today teaching, we're in the midst of the last time, because the Bible says the Jews are going to go back to the Holy Land, and this war going on between Israel and Hamas is just the springboard for that. So we're on the cusp of all of the end time events of Scripture. But they would teach, again, the literal physical descendants of Abraham through Jacob are going to be converted en masse and go back and live in the land. We'll deal with that one. Second major teaching is this. Christ is not currently reigning on David's throne now, but will reign on his literal throne in Jerusalem in Palestine during the millennium. So again, the premill teachers believe this thousand-year reign is going to be a literal reign of Christ on earth, where he will take the throne, but he's not there yet. Again, given your own knowledge of the Bible, think about that for a moment. The New Testament especially is full of verbiage. It talks about Christ reigning at the right hand of the Father right now.
Amen.
So you got to deal with that somehow. Number three, third prominent teaching, premill teaching. This is one of the most concerning ones to me. Premill teachers say that Christ intended to establish his kingdom when he came to this earth the first time, but the Jews rejected him, so God had to postpone the kingdom until a later date and establish the church in its place. So basically what they're saying is Christ couldn't do what he came to do the first time. So God says, oops, that caught me by surprise. I guess we need to go to plan B. And the church of God is plan B. God says, well, we'll put this in place for now till we can do it right the next time. I don't know about you, but I've got a problem with a God who can't accomplish his will the first time.
Amen.
And what gives us any hope? If God couldn't do it the first time, how are we going to know he can do it the second time? So, again, lots of problems there from my perspective. Finally, another glaring issue for me, and perhaps for you as well, premill teachers will say that the Jewish temple, the literal temple in Jerusalem, was destroyed finally in AD 70 and has never been rebuilt. Premill teachers will say that that temple will physically be rebuilt in Jerusalem, and temple services, temple sacrifices, and temple ceremonies will be reestablished. Once the Jews go back to their homeland, as they claim that will happen, that physical temple will be rebuilt. A lot of those old covenant practices are going to be reestablished. That's why you hear some, probably been months ago now, I preached a sermon and I used the illustration about the red heifer. You know, and that's why for years now, cattle breeders have been breeding perfect red heifers, because in anticipation of the rebuilding of this literal temple, because one of the rites under the Old Testament, you needed a red heifer to do that. And there's no way today for, I'm getting ahead of myself, I'm using stuff from the lessons. Anyway, the destruction of the Jewish temple in AD 70 destroyed all the records. There's no literal way to prove what tribe you're from today. But that doesn't stop some people. They're still looking. They're finding people, young men, they believe are from the line of Aaron. Because if you're going to reinstitute the temple and the sacrifices, guess what? You're going to have some Levites. This is almost to the extreme. Well, I'll save that for later. Anyway, they claim this temple is going to be rebuilt. That's why there's so much turmoil, and has been so much turmoil in the Middle East for centuries. Because guess what? Right now, and this literal physical temple has to be built in the same place. Well, what's there now?
Golden Dome.
Yeah, you've got a Muslim mosque. So that's got to be torn down to make room for the temple. And the Muslims, they're not going to stand for that. So that's the tension. That's the tension. But it doesn't matter. This is that they would claim behind all of this is God's word. Lord willing, as we examine the Bible in the month to come, we're going to see there's some serious problem with at least these four. There's some other things we'll talk about. But again, that's where we're headed. I should have been doing this. Let's just review, right? Israel, the physical descendants of Abraham through Jacob, will be nationally converted, restored to the land of Palestine. Christ is not reigning on David's throne, but now will reign on his literal throne in Jerusalem in Palestine during the millennium. Christ intended to establish his kingdom when he came to earth the first time, but the Jews rejected him. God then postponed the kingdom until a later date and established the church in its place. Finally, the Jewish temple will be rebuilt in Jerusalem, and temple services, sacrifices, and ceremonies will be established. these four things aren't the truth. Don't go home saying the preacher's teaching this. We'll be, Lord willing, refuting each one of these in the days to come.
Death will be there too.
So that just sets the stage for what we want to talk about. But think carefully about those claims. Get out your own Bibles this week. Most of you are good enough Bible students to hear those things and say, you know what, something doesn't sound right. Now, if something doesn't sound right to me, just because it doesn't sound right to me doesn't make it wrong. When something doesn't sound right, what ought we to do? Go to the Bible and check it, right? I want to believe and teach everything that's right, but I have a source book to go to that I have to base my beliefs on as a Christian. We want to examine, like the Bereans, right? Paul said, you know, don't just take, the Apostle Paul said, don't just take what I say as the gospel. They went and checked it out, see whether those things were so. I would encourage you to do the same thing. Let's stand and sing.